Of course, Fintech has been my first love because I started my career with Goldman Sachs in technology and then moved into algo trading for some time there before I decided to move back to India. So welcome, everyone. I hope everyone is able to hear me and I'm audible. So today, as Calvin said, what we'll do is we will quickly go over to define what is Fintech. And I am assuming, and when I went through some of the profile of the audience, you are from banking and finance industry, so this should not be new to you. So we won't spend a lot of time on that. But then we'll spend some time analyzing what is happening with, in terms of which industries under the financial domain, especially banking, are getting disrupted. And as part of that, what kind of new roles are emerging for you as a professional in finance or financial technology industry? How can you prepare yourself? I think that's one of the very important goals of today's session, and be ready for those kind of changes. And the last week cover about the skills that are required and some roles which are open with some of the companies in India, just to give you an example. So before we talk about fintech, okay, fin as in finance and tech as in technology, let's look at some of the very high level challenges that have been there in traditional banking. Due to which the emergence of technology and the acceptance of technology happened. One very critical area is transparency. You know that when a customer comes to you or you go to a bank to take a loan, in the traditional days, things have changed recently, but in the traditional days, it used to be a way where you don't know much about what's going on in the selection of your application. What are the parameters? What are the inputs that they're evaluating for you as a customer, right? See, of course, you know that you have a CIBIL score and you might have some other details that you submit to them, like your income tax returns and financial statements. But still, the process of evaluation, the process of selection was not very disclosed to the customer transparently. It has not changed a lot, but it has improved much in the last few years. The second area is channels. We have been, at least I have been, I have lived the days when I used to go to the branch for almost everything that I have to do. And then ATMs came to picture gradually. Then I stopped going to the bank branch if I have to just withdraw the money or look at my statement. And then even further, the markets evolved. While I was in US, I in fact could just deposit a check also from home by just taking a photograph. And I stopped going to the branch. There was one thing that evolved very drastically. And more importantly, the channel of the customer touch points became very technical in nature. My mobile phone became my primary source of interacting with my bank and maybe a phone call, rather than every time going to the branch or talking to a person or a human. And nowadays, you must see banks are adopting latest technologies like for customer service, there are things like chatbot, right? Chatbot is like a technology where you program a system to respond to the queries of the customer, which are predefined, okay? And the, so the channel have become very digital now. Third was expensive. I think this is still there, that a lot of products and services that you buy from your bank, whether you go and deposit your money and take a fixed deposit and get an interest rate on that, or you take a loan, personal loan or financial or commercial loan, or you take any other services. In the olden days, it used to be very costly. It used to be slow as well. And in terms of the processing fee and the charges were higher comparatively. But with the evolution of technology, since bank could reduce their cost of operations because of technology, they could actually pass some of the benefit onto the customers. Recent days, I have not heard a bank which will say that, sir, don't worry, you come to us and we won't charge you any processing or any documentation fee and et cetera. They might behind the scene be covering that cost somewhere else from me, but at least from a general population perspective, like today, if I have to transfer money to someone via Paytm, it's almost free to me. Third is performance. That has been an area where technology has helped immensely in the last few years, in the last decade, I would say, where the speed of transaction has improved a lot. If you think about IMPS or RTGS, instantly you can transfer money, instantly you can apply for loan online, instantly you can actually open a bank account nowadays with the new banks such as IndusInd and other, where you can just go online and open a bank account with Aadhaar and other things. So that brings us to KYC, which has also improved a lot. Technology has helped immensely here, especially the areas such as multiple documentation that were required earlier. Hopefully, Aadhaar will pick up. I think something happened recently in India where Aadhaar had some issues and there were a lot of debate going on. But even if you look at the type of KYC has changed, right, with your PAN card, your tax filing have improved a lot, and so on. And you can manage and maintain your record in a single place. And the last is risk and fraud management. We know, I think, if you are in the banking industry for last 10 years, you would have heard of what happened with Lehman Brothers in 2008. And then the downfall of the financial market globally, the subprime loan and the mortgage crisis. So that and many other frauds that have happened in the financial institution, which is also a very heavily regulated industry, has actually given a room for technology to come and play a very important role in managing the risk, in identifying the type of fraud. Technology such as artificial intelligence has actually helped immensely by creating models in machines which can start identifying patterns of fraud or anti-money laundering, for example, AML. If you think of the recent exposure of Indian customer to latest areas such as wallets and PPIs and P2P lendings and other things, technology is helping you to lend money to someone by just going online and applying for a smaller loan and getting that loan financed by a crowdfunding mechanism, right? But at the same time, you have to understand that also entails that I have mechanism to properly authenticate, validate the person, both the lender and the borrower. And I'm able to also understand if there is any kind of suspicious red flags that I need to look at. As a human being, it's not possible for all of us to process a lot of data at a very faster speed. And that's where machine learning or that's where technology comes into play. So these are the six pillars that I think that have been benefited a lot because of technology. Okay, now let's look at this slide where it basically a report by CB Insights, which talks about the umbrella of what is covered under fintech. Okay, now I've been told by Imarticus that the most of the audience today is from banking, but if you look at the spectrum, starting from lending on the left hand side to regulatory tech to personal finance, payments and billing, insurance, capital markets, even wealth management, where I come from. So I used to have a lot of personal wealth management customers in Goldman Sachs, or money transfer and remittances, or my mortgage and real estate. So these are the areas which have different applications where technology comes and play a very important role, right? Whether it is lending, whether it is identifying a credit score, whether it is evaluating someone's background, whether it is calculating an insurance premium, or it is doing an algorithmic trading. One area which I didn't pick was blockchain and crypto, which we are going to talk about in our slides, the next few slides. A very, very important technology, a very powerful one. It became popular because of Bitcoin, but it has many other applications, and we'll touch upon that briefly as we move forward. What are some of the key trends? And this is a report by McKinsey, which is banking and beyond banking, right? If you look at retail, some of the peer-to-peer lending and investment, multiple aggregation technologies, and next generation personal finance, right? So this is an area which has helped to in penetration of financing in the B2C segment. If you look at payments, of course, we all are aware of Paytm and the like, mobile payments. We use for international remittances also, and point of sale devices or POS machines, right? Where you just go and put your credit card in and you swipe it. And with NFC, one of the technology that was made popular by Apple Pay, is where you can just touch your card and actually make the payment. It happens in US, it is happening and slowly picking up in India as well. Think of insurance and wealth management, like using robotic systems for advising the customer on wealth management rather than always involving a human being there. Okay, it's not that human being is going to be replaced completely. It's going to play a very important role of an advisor still, but robots or machines can start actually churning a large amount of data, and they can start supporting or advising the customer with much more insight about them or about the market. Like if I want to buy a property in Gurgaon today, I actually can use some models which are out there to give me a proper pricing of in my market or in my area of interest, rather than just relying on the manual agents who can say, sir, don't worry, this is 1 crore today and this is going to go up next. You should buy this property, this is her. But I can complement that information from technology, right? Insights. Capital markets, small and mid-sized enterprises, they are also picking up very fast. There is a company called Power to SME that does if you talk of peer-to-peer lending, there is Percent, and there are many others that are coming up. Now let's look also at one other area, which is telematics, IoT, and connected devices. That have also changed the way that insurance are sold in many countries, and it's coming up in India. ICICI Lombard has implemented that, which is called as UBI, usage-based insurance, or pay the insurance as you go, which really means that I will give you the benefit of the insurance premium or a discount on that if you are a good driver. If you don't drive in the night, if your office is not too far from your home, if you don't overspeed and etc. That means by connecting some devices in your vehicles, I will track your patterns and behaviors as an insurance company. And then on your next renewal or maybe 3 months down the line, offer you a discount or a premiums, reduced premium value. So if you see multiple technologies like artificial intelligence, Internet of Things, blockchain, cloud computing, even enhanced processing power, mobile phones, smartphones, they all have come together to enable multiple exposures or multiple value generation for all stakeholders in the financial industry, right? Now let's quickly at the banking part of it. So I already touched upon this. Now, if you think of the traditional banks or the larger player, incumbents, we can call them SBI, ICICI, HDFCs, or even Kotak, Yes Bank, IDFCs. So if you look at an example here, ICICI Bank, they partner with a company called as Nikki.ai, which builds AI-based chatbot. So I told you an example of how chatbot can enhance my customer service by giving some real-time responses to my customer who comes to my website or my app. They worked with a company for doing paperless onboarding of customers, right? Which I touched upon, the KYC part. Look at SBI. SBI worked with or is working with a company called as Prime Chain Technologies, which is into using blockchain for banking industry. We'll talk about blockchain and we'll see how it is applicable for a banking or a financial industry and what benefit it can bring to them. But on the left-hand side, look at Kotak. For consumer credit scoring, they work with Credit Seva in addition to, of course, getting the CIBIL score. You know why? Because Credit Seva says that in addition to your traditional banking records, like your financial statement, your income tax return, and your CIBIL score and other things, I will also try to bring the social footprint of a customer into the picture for creating a credit score. For example, if Vinay Solanki goes on vacation and posts his photos on Facebook, right? Now suddenly I go to look for a loan. They can start first understanding from my footprint on social media that what are my regular spending pattern? And am I taking this personal loan for going on a vacation, or am I taking it for making extra payment on my housing EMI or something else, right? That's just an example. It's easier said than done. It's a hard thing to do. It's not like I can go to LinkedIn, Facebook, get every info about Calvin and then say, hey, Calvin, I will reject your loan because I think you go to this bar every night and you're a heavy drinker. I'm just taking an example. I don't know if Kevin drinks or not, But the idea here is to understand that technology is helping banking to realize that I cannot work like a traditional bank. I have to adopt technologies very rapidly, which means people, if you are into a career phase where you're thinking your next step or next career, you should bring that tech part of the fin and consider very actively. People would have heard of Alipay. Alipay is an arm of Alibaba, which started 10 years ago as a payments company, as a payment wallet. It's like a Paytm. Now, if you look at even Paytm, Paytm has evolved to running multiple other things, right? Payment bank and Paytm Mall and many other things, booking tickets and making bill payments and etc. Even Alipay, after 10 years, today has become actually a very integrated financial ecosystem. And it does everything from wealth management to insurance to lending to credit scoring, everything. And it is an important arm of Alibaba as a company. In fact, Ant Financial is now ranked among the world's most valuable financial services firm. See, that's a surprising number to some of you, that compared with JP Morgan and Wells Fargo and Bank of America and the big ones, HSBC, this player has emerged only in the last 10 years. And it has quickly grown in the hierarchy and is in the top 10. And you never know, it might actually grow very rapidly compared to the traditional banks and take over. And the same could happen with companies in India or outside India. This actually is just to give you an overview that when you look at a payment processing ecosystem, okay, or transaction management or transaction processing ecosystem, there is not only one single player like the banks or the acquirer or processor. There are multiple players in the financial industry, starting with the acquirer and processors, which are typically companies like the traditional bank and other companies, Wells Fargo, Citibank, etc. The card network we are aware of, MasterCard, Visa, Discover, MX, and so on, which are the companies that provide you that service to take credit and make your payment. Then, of course, there are issuers that issue financial transactions or that issue financial products into the industry. And they work very closely with the card networks and other companies. There are gateways which are used as a pipe to do the transaction and to also sometimes settle the transaction. So if you heard of Bill Desk in India, Bill Desk is one of the very popular payment gateway. So whenever you go on any site, if you go to pay a school fee of your kid, many times you'll see Bill Desk, and then there will be an option to use credit card, debit card, wallets, net banking, ATM, etc., debit cards, and so on. So they act like a pipe that takes the money from one account and it flows the money to another account, and then they are done. They are not responsible to store your money. They are not responsible to settle your transaction in some cases, but they act like a pipe. And then there are ISOs or MSPs, which are companies like Fidelity, North American, Paywire, and so on, which play in the ISO space. So the payment processing ecosystem is huge and humongous, which also says that for you as a professional who is looking for a career move, there is multiple areas that you can look at. It's not only one specific segment or vertical that you can go for. So we touched on this briefly, which is P2P lending, peer-to-peer lending. Actually, if you look at the left-hand side part, the lending card, in India, in the quarter one of 2018, the amount of investment that has started going into companies which are into lending businesses, like small business lending by lending card, got $87 million funding. A micro lender like Away Finance or even early salary, which gives you advance against your salary statements or pay slips as an early salary kind of a thing. So if your salary is due on 5th of the month and you need immediate money on the 1st of the month, you can go and work with them. Or even asset-backed online lender like Rupeek. So India, China, these two countries specifically, which are huge in terms of population and hence the demand for the market, this kind of players are emerging very rapidly. In fact, yesterday I was speaking at one of the conferences in Gurgaon on market research tech and how data privacy and data security plays a role there. There I met a company called as FairSend, the CMO of the FairSend, and we were discussing about how do they lend money using P2P model. It basically they do crowdfunding. It's like, let's say Calvin needs 5 lakh rupees and Vinay and 10 other people are part of the lending part of this PairSend. They might send a request to all of us and probably get 50,000 from each of us to lend 5 lakh to Calvin. Okay. So based on his credit history and everything, they will decide whether he can be lend a money of 5 lakh. A person can lend up, can borrow from, I think, 1,000 rupees to 10 lakh. That's the range. 10 lakh is the maximum set by RBI and it's regulated. Okay. They have a license of NBFC. So that's a very interesting area. It's a startup, but doing very well. So startup is another area that can be considered for your career move, rather than just going to a traditional big players. So that's the one I was talking about, fairsend.com. Gold, selling gold, selling or buying gold, which is used to be a very traditional way of, in India at least, where you go to your next door sonar or jeweler, your family jeweler, Paytm or phone pay, these people, they started leveraging online platform and they started selling gold. In fact, they have sold more than 1,000 kilograms in 10 months. And this is an old news. So by now it could be even 2,000 kilograms or even more. So what people are thinking, they have realized that India is a huge market, fragmented, okay? And Indian customer has a habit of investing in different kind of assets. We invest mostly in fixed assets, either house or gold or traditional fixed deposits and other things. And we are also rapidly changing as a country where we are now investing in mutual funds and SIPs and other markets. So if you think of this, there is a lot of opportunity for a country of more than 1 billion population and with a growing income and disposable income, where they can be attacked or they can be targeted as a customer segment for newer financial products, I would say. Uber, we all are popular, we are aware of Uber, we use it very actively. Uber in US actually realized that 30% of their drivers who apply for Uber driver license don't have a bank account. So it's surprising. I was really surprised. I thought in US as a country, almost 100% of the population would have a bank account at least. But for them, the 30% of the people were missing it. And they realized that because it is mandatory for a bank account for the driver, they actually launched a Uber bank. They said that they started working with a traditional bank and created a product where they said, you come to my platform to register as a driver. By putting your KYC, which is an SSN number in US called a social security number, I will open a bank account for you immediately, like a checking account, which is similar to a savings account in India. Using this now, you can your income that you're going to get from my driving business will be credited to your account directly. And that increased the penetration of banking into that 30% segment. So see, it's like banking by Uber is something very unrelated, right? It's a mobility company that provides you mobility service. But if you think of how technology has really impacted, now even this non-traditional player can start thinking of how they can become a channel for banking. So that was the background about what is happening in the market. I want to now start talking about the career prospects. And of course, I will also touch on various technologies like blockchain, RPA, and other areas. The main reason I have highlighted that word tech, the reason is that the technology is disrupting every industry. It's not just finance, okay? It's disrupting manufacturing, it's disrupting retail, okay? It's housing, and every industry that you deal with in your day-to-day basis. Technology is coming and playing a very active role. It is defining new paradigms and new dimensions of operations. So the bigger players, or even the traditional incumbents, cannot just sit idle and say, hey, I will rule for the next 10 years. I don't have to do much. I don't have to change, right? We know what happened with Nokia. So we have to look at technology as a very important aspect of financial services. And more importantly, if you are a person who is more dealing with commercial segment, right? Let's say you are a wealth manager, or you are a branch manager, or you handle customers like SME customers or large customers for your current company, and you deal with them on a day-to-day basis. One of the important area that you have to start learning or becoming familiar with is technology. and be a techno-commercial guy. Like if you take an example of me today, I'm a very commercial guy, but because I deal with business development and running a business unit for Lenovo. But then I also need to know technology very, very well in order to sell it, right? For you, you're selling financial products. But since it is so closely now getting knitted with each other, it's important to become techno-commercial. So this slide talks about the stakeholder of fintech. Now, let's first look at the darker blue ones in the center. So these are infrastructure providers, the technology providers, the startups that we touched upon, and the banking and the financial institutions. So these are the core players that come together to create financial fintech products, right? Or a fintech service or offering. So we talked about ICICI as a bank working with a startup to implement a chatbot. And the infrastructure could be the cloud where the chatbot runs or is stores the data on. Or the tech provider could be Microsoft that is providing the cloud services and many other things, right? So these are the core people who are now coming close with each other to create newer financial services. And then if you look at regulators and government, they are also making sure that they stay up to the speed with technology. For example, payment bank licensing that came to India a few years back when I was in Airtel and I was running the payments bank, fraud and risk management in India and Africa. So that time the regulators used to work with companies like Airtel and also the financial technology companies to understand what are the dimensions of a payment bank should be for India and what role they should play. See, payment banks are still evolving as a service, but the idea was that they played a role to make sure that customer gets some kind of a benefit by making sure that the industry adopts technology in a win-win situation. It should not be that I have to enforce some regulation and deter the innovation in the market. And then, of course, there are investors and incubators which are allowing you to understand and adopt the emerging technologies or support the startup ecosystem to grow, to get funding so that they can provide their services and expand their business and scale up. If you think of the scope of work of fintech, I think you should be familiar by now because of all the examples we have discussed. It is moving from core banking and expanding very rapidly as a fintech industry into investments, lending, personal finance management, and payments, right? And this darker blue, which is the core banking area, I think very soon it might become very grayish. It means it won't be like that. There is a core banking as a as a product. The banking and fintech will become so, like technology and banking will become so intertwined that you will just treat that as a professional product or a service that you as a consumer want to consume. You won't care where it is coming from. For example, the P2P case, I don't care where that 5 lakh is coming from. I am a consumer who needs to borrow money. Of course, I do care how do I repay it, but I'm always looking for a new channel to get it cheaply comparatively. If I'm a personal finance management guy, then I need to make sure that I advise my client that what kind of investments they have to do and for which I can also advise that what kind of technologies that are emerging and which are going to impact certain industries. And hence, you should probably focus your stock investment or your SIP investment in segments which are going to do well in the longer horizon, right? So this is a snippet from Economic Times, which actually this was recently in the newspaper and I loved it. I was trying to understand that what is the spectrum or what is the divide of functional area for people to work. By the way, the top line, men at work, please don't take it men at work. It is men/women at work. I think I don't want a hashtag me too. But the idea here is that top functional areas of fintech industries, if you look at the 51% is coming from in IT, telecom, software sector area, which is the role of developers. There is a 16% coming from sales and business development, 11% from core finance knowledge, like a CA or a financial advisor or a planner or a registered investment advisor, RIA, and so on. And then there are corporate planning and consulting, and there is a top management. Now, the experience split is between 0 to 10 years, where the maximum hiring is happening between 2 to 5 years. Of course, that's very obvious because that's the low experience, high volume kind of hiring. But then there is the effective hiring going on between 5 to 7 and 7 to 10 as well. And that's a sector where if you are in your mid-career and you are looking to change or you're looking to move or you're looking to grow vertically in your own current role, then you have to start thinking about how do you adopt these technologies. The top industry on the right-hand side says that the 26% was in financial services and stockbroking. And then the rest comes after that, right? So that's a good news. We have to look at this chart from a perspective of saying that what skills do I have today, which is, let's say, skill A, B, and C. What do I need tomorrow, which is D, E, and F, which is probably technology, if I don't have that. Or if I have technology, then it could be more financial side of exposure. And then combine them together to create my profile as an all-around techno-commercial professional, right? So that I'm competitive in the market for a very longer horizon. Some of the sample rules, this is something I also got from online. If you look on the right-hand side, multiple companies, Bank of America, Citibank, E-Trade, Perpay, Watchman, etc. And on the technical side, there are certain rules like help desk engineer, con developers. I was a con developer myself when I was in Goldman, data analyst, visual designer, and engineering manager. These are more technical roles, like people who focus on product development. And then there are techno-commercial roles, which is where there are multiple areas, starting from someone who is focusing on developing the business in the market. But even that guy need to be aware of technology so that he talks the language of the customer. Product managers, so different financial products, whether it is lending, wallet, wealth management, insurance, underwriting, loans, etc. Different products, but with the flavor of making sure that you understand how technology is going to enable my customer to adopt my product rapidly. Loyalty and engagement, treasury manager, senior financial analyst, and then strategy and analytics and reporting. That's more in the role of someone who is more in the research or preparing dashboards and reporting and generating insights for their customers, right? So these are some of the roles which are coming up. Now, how do I prepare myself? What are the technologies that I should look at? Okay, so one of the area that I really love, and I think that holds a lot of promise, is analytics, is data, right? And we all have heard this word, right? Data is the new oil. Maybe today it has not expanded very rapidly, or the scale of analytics is still growing, but the room and opportunity for data to become the real main source of revenue and be the monetization factor for all of us will be very soon. Probably 5 years, probably 3 years. It depends on the industry that we're talking about. So AI is enabling in multiple sectors, from personalizing the portfolio of a customer to enriching the credit score. We touched on that, right? That I can use your social media footprint or maybe some other data about you, not necessarily social media, maybe your buying pattern, maybe your payment patterns, your transactions from your wallet, and etc. Customer service, this is something I think has picked up very rapidly in both financial and other industries, where people are adopting chatbots for customer service. And it is adding a lot of ROI for the businesses, because they can reduce the number of people in the call center, and more importantly, they can be very instant. They can support 100,000 customers in a single maybe in a single minute by running at multiple chatbots. Performance, I think I mentioned this. See, when you look at transactions, when you look at settlements, when you look at anything that has to be done over a period of time. You go and send your transaction to RBI, the settlement happens, or the checks get cleared in the system, whether current account or not. The things need to improve. The customer wants speed. They want things at the tap of a finger today. And AI is helping there, and technologies like faster processing or newer areas where people are using big data, cloud computing, real-time edge processing, and etc. to improve the performance, right? Your smartphone has become very, very powerful these days. It's a powerful computer in your hand, and that can do a lot. Compliance and regulatory is also adopting artificial intelligence. in order to do auditing. Because see, when you go to a bank and say, give me all your financial report. In the olden days, if you get a pile of three boxes full of paper, or maybe some records in Excel sheets, etc., how much time do you take to go and find those red flags when you're auditing someone? Think of an AI tool like robotic process automation, which can be programmed to look for those patterns in the data and find those discrepancy in the balance sheet or in the financial statement or in profit and loss statement, and give you an alert to say that maybe there is something wrong in this part of the month or this transaction. And then, of course, AML, viruses, threats, fraud detection has I think an important application of pattern analysis and data analysis both. Okay, so in fact, in the anti-money laundering area in Airtel, I was working on adopting when I was there a solution by a startup, which was very unique in its way of identifying the patterns which can red flag a money laundering kind of an instance. Since our customers were in Africa, that is even more prone to money laundering as a country, this was very useful for us. Okay, blockchain, I'm sure you would have heard of this word, at least Bitcoin. So see, what is blockchain in a layman term before we go through the slides? It's a distributed ledger, okay, which is immutable in its nature. So once a record has been written into the ledger, it cannot be mutated very easily. So in principle, you can mutate it, but in practice, it is very hard to mutate it. And it is a distributed trust mechanism. What I mean by that in traditional banking, you trust your bank, right? You go, you deposit lakhs of money in a bank. You transfer money from one bank account, and then you trust the bank and the RBI, right? Now, you put your trust in a single centralized entity that could very well fail or could be rogue, right? Example of Lehman Brothers, right? That it couldn't find how to understand. Lehman couldn't see the risk coming. So what is blockchain saying? That I am a decentralized database, a distributed ledger, where multiple players on my nodes in the system, they can see the transaction that is happening in the system. Of course, anonymously. That means if Vinay transfer money to Calvin, the system doesn't know who is transferring to whom. It just knows that the transaction happened from party A to party B of this much amount. Or it could be some other record that I'm going to store. I deposit money to my account, for example. Now, blockchain became popular because of Bitcoin. Bitcoin was the first cryptocurrency which became popular. And then it also saw its downfall, where retailer also started accepting payments in cryptocurrencies in Bitcoin. But then Bitcoin is one of the application, or cryptocurrency is one of the applications of blockchain. Blockchain also plays a role in smart contracts. It also plays a role in multiple other areas such as security, transaction security, and so on. If you think of blockchain, think it like a page where you are writing a record, okay, which is a block of 100 records. And then you start chaining the second block to the first block, which is of another 100 records, and the third block to the second block, which is of another 100 records. So basically what you're saying, you're chaining multiple blocks, and hence the term blockchain. Basically, the network is a chain of computers that must all approve an exchange or a transaction before it is verified and recorded. Okay, I don't want to go too deep into the technology, but it provides stringent controls on enabling smart contracts and auditable data. So we touched on the aspect of compliance and auditing, right? So blockchain can play an important role where it can enable very quick auditing on multiple records stored by a banking institution. As per NASDAQ, the most notable app will be the transformation of payments for banks and customers, because blockchain can reduce the cost of transaction. And in future, so today blockchain is not as fast as it has to be, or it can be, but it will become faster as we move forward. Okay. And then, as I said, the retailers are accepting payments in cryptocurrencies because the cost to process the payment on service like BitPay is less than 3% of the transaction fee a credit card would charge. So why would I go and accept payment in MasterCard and Visa? Why won't I start accepting money on BitPay, right? So, and then the last, I think, for today is RPA, before we open it for Q&A. So we talked about AI, machine learning, cloud computing, IoT, blockchain. Now, when we talk about AI, we also talk about an area in financial industry where we say that if there is a routine task or a repeatable task in front of me, okay, I can use RPA to automate that task. Basically, anything which is very high in volume, okay? Let's say you could hire a person to monitor all the credits in a particular bank in a day, which could be millions, right? For ICICI Bank, for example. And you want there someone to record it, monitor, or do a cross-check. And then, of course, you adopt technology for that. So RPA can say that if it is a high volume, repeatable, and a defined, well-defined task that needs to be done, okay, then I can implement this solution. It can reduce the time and also the cost for me. The financial industry is a regulated industry with a lot of mandate on reliability, auditability, and data quality, right? So adding automation such as RPA can actually make it much easier, faster, efficient for the organization to comply with these regulations. And the last slide. So if you look at fintech unicorn, so I told you about how we can look at blockchain and multiple areas or AI or machine learning or any other technology to do our next move in the career in our financial industry. Look at this, like where it says that the number of unicorns, 26 of them valued at $77 billion globally. Okay. Now, this is a huge insight into telling us that if I have to move or prepare myself for my next phase of career, then I think I should look at innovative startups as well to get into. So that's it from my side. Calvin, we can open it for Q&A now. So I think the first one I've already covered, what is the role of data science in fintech? So Akash, we touched on how artificial intelligence or machine learning has a role in multiple areas of financial industry. So wherever you need to find insight, right? Wherever you need a model to adopt and to reinvent itself by looking at more and more data, that's where AI or data science as a field plays a role, right? For example, look at an example of P2P lending. So a lot of this credit scoring that happens on a particular customer, it's not someone human doing it. It's actually a machine running an algorithm to say that I will look at this Vinay Solanki, find all these important inputs, and then run a model on top of it to give a credit score for it. Okay. The next one is from Vangala. Is Imarticus providing any fintech? Kelvin, can you take that?
Yes, of course, Vinay. Vangala and everyone else, yes, Imarticus does offer a fintech course. The course is online, so it's definitely great for working professionals who are already in the finance industry. You can learn based on your own time and on your own at your own convenience. The course covers everything that you would need in the fintech domain to be successful. It basically begins with a primer on fintech. It talks about financial markets and financial services as well. It also touches upon blockchain analytics and machine learning and their implementations in fintech. It would also teach you robotic process automation and design thinking and experiential learning. So yep, Imarticus does have a comprehensive fintech course, and I'd invite you all to visit our website or get in touch with our counselors to know more.
The next question is from Krishna. I think it's about how long fintech has evolved. So Krishna, fintech, I think if I'm correct, like when I was in Goldman in 2007, I already saw Bitcoin coming up back then. And I feel it is even before that where the adoption of technology in financial industry started in multiple ways, even the wallets and other things. I think it is, I can guess it is more than a decade now. Yatharth, I just started preparing for actuarial sciences. Is there any scope of fintech there? Sorry, Yatharth, I have no idea about actuarial sciences, so I won't be able to answer this question. How to start with algorithmic trading? There is the next question. I don't see the name. So algorithmic trading needs two expertise. I don't see your name though, but one area is understanding the mathematical modeling of a financial product. So when I was working on fixed income bonds, and I did a course with Carnegie Mellon, a part-time course on computational finance, where I learned different kind of stochastic and other pricing models to be implemented in my bond pricing and risk management. So to start with algorithmic trading, you have to mix two things. One, you have to understand how to write a code, either in R, Python or so. I used to write in R. And second is you need to understand the mathematical aspect of looking at a product and pricing and modeling it. The next is, do you think fintech guys are almost equivalent to software engineers? Very good question, Krishna. Brilliant question, I would say. I think, see, it's important to look at the boundary of, I told you earlier, right, in my slides, that the boundary between a traditional business like finance and technology, because of fintech, is becoming very gray. So is there a software developer who can be called as a fintech guy or an engineer? Yes. If you are a product manager in, let's say, Google Pay vertical, and you are writing a system to build the Google Pay transaction management system, you can be, you are a fintech guy because you are servicing the customer in the fintech industry. And the other way around as well, that let's say you are a private wealth manager who is traditionally advising the families in India for wealth management. But now if you start adopting technology so that you can advise them better, because you can use AI and machine learning and get some insight for them faster, called as a fintech guy, but you're not a software engineer there. The next is Akhil Anand. I was part of tech and recently made a move to one of the global banks. What should be the starting point? See, I think the starting point, of course, you can start taking a course by Imarticus and learn fintech as a technology, and then prepare yourself well. And also what you should do is keep up to date with what is going on around you. Reading newspaper, reading articles, following some people on LinkedIn, Twitter, and other media, following some leaders. Today, maybe RP is very popular, and maybe tomorrow, in 3 months down the line, it could be something new. To keep yourself up to date with technology. And starting with on this will be good. Anubha, thanks a lot. Only once I could kindly see panorama, I can see that. Okay. Next is Gunjan. How BCom graduates can enter into this industry? Any specific certificate or skill? Okay. So this is a good question. In fact, conference where I was a speaker on fintech, they had this question about what people or a pure CA, chartered accountant, or maybe those kind of area, maybe actuarial science is one of them. How do I prepare myself for fintech? See, it's a good area to think of. That let's say if you understand your area very well, right, or a commerce, right? You understand accounting, let's say, because of the income. Now your technology to be a competitive person in the industry. So now let's say you are helping a customer on the accounting research and accounting side. Now you can help them to a certain extent, but if you know how to adopt technologies like either RPA, right? Because I said RPA is a good, your advice to your customer will be more enriched. That means you become more competitive compared to your peer to grow in your career. Next is I'm from a non-tech background and into operations for payments domain. Can I take a blockchain technology for future prospect? Does it require? Yes. Blockchain requires a technology experience because blockchain is a complicated technology. Now there are people who can sell as blockchain as a service to someone, and maybe they don't need to program in blockchain. But if you think of me who is selling IoT now, or think of someone who is going to sell blockchain, or at least use blockchain to sell something else. Both the areas, whether you're adopting it in your operations or in payments domain, you need to understand it a little deeper, because you cannot just read blockchain on website and then actually go and comfortably talk about it with your customers. For example, the BitPay, right, which is now adopted as a retail currency. Now for the retailer, they don't need to know anything about it. They just need to use a POS device that supports accepting BitPay. But the company that is building that POS, or company that is settling that BitPay transaction, or the company that is providing the service of a credit management and underwriting that transaction, need to understand, I'm just the person in those companies, need to understand blockchain a little deeper, right? Because if things go wrong, then you need to be aware of what is happening around you. Next question, Calvin, you want to take this? This is, does Imarticus help in getting a job in fintech?
Yeah, sure, Vinay. Well, Imarticus, Santosh Imarticus, does train you in fintech, and we do provide you assistance with, you know, in terms of preparing you for interviews and, you know, preparing you to enter the fintech domain. But we don't per se, you know, place you in fintech companies.
Next is, in a nutshell, if you have to say the skills needed for tomorrow, what would be apart from being techno-commercial professional? So apart from being technology aware and commercially aware, one of the skill that will be very high in demand, that's my personal area, because I take sessions on personal branding and communications at colleges. This is about making sure that your communications, your articulation of your thoughts, your way of dealing with the customers, whether they are enterprise or consumer, is very clear. Because what is happening, someone who can talk well and be very clear and layman in their way of explaining products can sell the product better. So that is a soft skill that is very, very important in the future. And personal branding and creating a personal space in today's world where there are millions like you who will be competing for the same customer, or at least a few thousands. You have to be aware of how do you stand out, and soft skills are helpful there. Next is, can you differentiate between business analytics and data analytics? No, actually they are not different. Analytics is analytics which you run on top of a data. What the only difference could be that business analytics is more from insights to be given to the business user or the leader in your company who needs to make some decisions. Data analytics is more at the ground level, where you say that you bring the raw data and you analyze the data. How blockchain shall be useful for banks? So I think I covered this already. So one of the areas that the companies are adopting blockchain is basically to provide newer services on top of blockchain. So if you think of, let me think of the name of the bank I studied who were adopting blockchain in Germany, I think. Forgot the name of the bank. But their product was like this, that tomorrow, if I need to lend someone, and give out a loan, and Bitcoin is, let's say, is a cryptocurrency where the person can actually repay the loan in. Can I enable that or not? Okay, think of this, that if you want to buy a Bitcoin today, you have to give out real money. Okay, but Bitcoin is what? It's a virtual money. So the banks are saying that, can I combine virtual and real money in a transaction where I lend someone, let's say today, 1 lakh INR, and in terms of return of EMI, I can accept a currency which is real, or you can also pay me back in virtual currency if you own a virtual currency. That's one way of doing it. That's a very innovative way, but it's a complicated one. It will take time for regulatory to evolve also. Next is, how do you foresee opportunity for banking product? I think I covered this in fintech blockchain space. Romita, how the fintech is evolving around latest security threats? So yes, so threats and prevention, right? Especially in the fraud management, risk management, viruses and hacking and other incidents, what is happening is that financial industries are working with multiple players. So there is a company called Subex that is very good in fraud and risk management. Yes. Now what they do is, they work with you, they leave some software inside your system which keeps an eye on what is happening and who is looking at your data, who is trying to get access to your transaction in your database in real time, using a combination of machine learning and very high-end technologies. We talked about chatbots, right? So there is an area called as bots, and bots are the people, it's a program that can, not people, it's a program that can replicate itself. And that is attacking much, much faster than the traditional hacking incident. So fintech are adopting technologies to prevent attacks from bots, which is very rapid. There is an article I can share with maybe Calvin, which talks about how people are taking prevention against the attacks of bots. I've taken CIBOP from Imarticus. I do know this. I think Mangala has already left. You can take this question, Calvin, later on. The last one is from Naveen, I think. For people from non-engineering background, with good experience in banking, business banking to be precise, what tech-based learning would you suggest? I think I have covered this. What are the prospects of RegTech? Yeah, good question. So regulatory tech is a good area which is upcoming. And I touched on, on when I spoke about the traditional challenges of regulatory and compliance. So regulators are more police that says that I ask you to operate in this boundary, and if you go beyond the boundary, then I will impose some kind of a fine or a penalty on you. Now, when they have to look at 100 banks in India on a daily basis, it's humanly impossible, right, to look and monitor each of them. Now, in the traditional ways, they used to monitor them every frequent period interval, like 30 days, 60 days, by looking at their audits and reports and other things, right? But RegTech, because of the evolution of multiple technologies, now they are saying that I will go and I will start monitoring you near real time, so that I can catch if something is going wrong way ahead of the time. And RegTech is an important area. Dapayan, you can just Google on RegTech. In LinkedIn, actually, I saw some article by one of the company that is selling some solutions in RegTech. How fintech can develop in future? What is fintech entrepreneur? Okay, fintech entrepreneur is a guy who start a company and provide some kind of a service around financial. One was Paysend.com that we covered. I'm Lakshmi. I have real experience in banking. Want to grow in my career. So if learn any of the category which you provided, how much helpful to me and any possible to get in international placement? Which I can answer that directly, but I can tell you that if you have experience in banking, and if you pick up, let's say you understand technology, you're an engineer. If you are an engineer by background, then you should look into a data science area. I think the combination of banking services and the data science is actually very, very powerful as a role in the industry. Do you know about anything about ROA model? If yes, could you explain? ROA model, I don't know. I don't know what you're talking. If you have the full form, you can put it on the chat, Ajal. You know, differential between business analysis, and I covered this. Okay. How to grab a better experience in fintech being a software engineer? So I think, see, if you're an engineer, Nand, and you want to get into a fintech company, you can start by just getting into a startup that needs programmers or software programmers like yourself to program something in AI, machine learning, RPA, cloud, mobile app, web app, etc. So when you start with that, being at the virtue of working in a financial fintech company, you will gradually learn finance and the dimension of how they're coming together and be more prepared and ready. You can, of course, read about how do you work in a P2P lending company, or how do you work for a Paytm kind of a player, and what kind of finance knowledge they would need from you. I don't think initially they would need one, but working in those companies, you will probably get familiar with fintech and then be more prepared and ready. Is data analytics same as data engineering? No. Data engineering is the old version of data analytics, where you actually manage, massage, store, retrieve, and architect the data system, the data ecosystem. Data analytics is that now data combined with machine learning, AI, data combined with big data applications is what analytics is all about. So the raw data, management of the raw data is more of data engineering, Sunny. And this is my understanding. And then analytics is deriving the patterns, the trends, the meaning, the graph, the plots, etc. Okay. So that's it. I think I've covered the rest of the question already in some other way.
Great. Thank you so much, Vinay, for answering all of the questions. Guys, for those of you who would like to explore a career in fintech, I do have Vishad here, who's going to give you a brief about the fintech course at Imarticus.
Hi guys, I hope you enjoyed the webinar. Thanks a lot, Vinay, for this. It was really useful and helpful. So I just want to take short amount of time, very briefly talk about the Imarticus fintech course. So I think Vinay has already covered a lot of these topics: blockchain, machine learning, robotic process automation, etc. And all of these things are covered in a lot of depth in the fintech course. So the beauty of the course is that you don't need to be a very technical person. Like, I mean, it's not about, you're not going to become a software developer or something like that. This gets your hands dirty. You actually go into using some of these technologies, but without you, and you don't need to be a very technical person. So to start off with. So if you have any of those apprehensions, you can allay those. What this course will do is, like I said, it'll give you practice with all of these things. It'll teach you how they're used in the fintech domain, blockchain analytics, in lending, in banking, in all of these various areas. And you'll understand exactly how analytics is used, how what kind of data is there, and how even how to use it. There are some very interesting case studies that you will be part of, that you will be required to do as part of the fintech course. So I would encourage all of you to if you're serious about a career in fintech, definitely consider the course and sign up for it. You can put in an inquiry on our website, and our counselors will a career counselor will reach out to you with more information. But you can go on the website and look at and even on YouTube we have a lot of videos about it. There's the CEO of Barclays talking about the fintech course. We have a detailed video on the entire curriculum, and so all of this is freely available online for you to check out. So I would really encourage you guys to check it out, we look forward to you guys signing up for the course. And if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to us at any point in time. Thanks.